Thank you, Madam Chairperson. Thank you, Madam Chairperson. At the onset, I have 18 minutes of allotted time by my party. Honourable Chairperson, sir, madam, I stand today on behalf of my party, the All India Trinamool Congress, to speak on the 75th anniversary of our Constitution. A Constitution that is not merely a book, but indeed the life and the soul of our nation. Almost 75 years ago to the day, on the 25th of November 1949, Baba Saheb Ambedkar reminded us, we must observe the caution which John Stuart Mill has given to all who are interested in the maintenance of democracy, namely, not to lay their liberties at the foot of even a great man or to trust him with powers which enable him to subvert their institutions. This nation was made by great men and women, but the real challenge before us today is ensuring that no one man should believe he's greater than the nation and that he is above the principles of the Constitution. Today, as I stand to participate in this historic debate, let me start with a short yet very apt nazm by the poet Dr. Hilal Farid. I trust the truth and the irony in his words will not be lost on anyone. Mubarak ghadi hai, kal sach dhajkar, makeup rachkar, khoob jachkar, dekho uska manch par aana, kitab samvidhan ki aankhon se lagana aur farmana, main sheesh ko jhukakar, is kitab ko man mein basakar, ishwar ki shapath leta hoon. Raat dhalne dijiye, दिल बदलने दीजिए, कल तलक ये बेवफा सितमगरों का बादशाह सब भूल जाएगा, नफरतें उगाएगा, दूरियां बढ़ाएगा, रोज संविधान के धज्जियां उड़ाएगा, मगर जो आज महफिल सजी है यही मानती है कि हीरो वही है, मुबारक घड़ी है. फॉर द पास्ट 10 years, अ वेरी लार्ज नंबर ऑफ पीपल इन दिस कंट्री हैव फेल्ट दैट संविधान खतरे में है. Our constitution is in danger. As responsible public representatives, it is imperative that we actually put this to the test and check if this is just fear mongering by us, as the ruling party would have us believe, or indeed is the constitution framework imperiled. As Professor Tarun Khaitan explains, there are three broad tests to check if the political executive is constitutionally accountable, three checks for the country to remain democratic over time. So let's see how our country is faring on these three checks. The first is direct electoral accountability to the people. The second, there is accountability to the judiciary and other fourth branch institutions. And third, there is accountability rendered by the media and civil society as watchdogs of the citizenry at large. The ruling party has the right to influence policies over a large range of matters. You cannot take away that prerogative, but it cannot usurp power in a way that kills constitutional rights for the rest of us. This government, this ruling party, when confronted with this charge, uses only one defense. What about Mrs. Gandhi's emergency? Yes, that was a full frontal attack on democracy. No question about that. But we saw it for what it was. This government's modus operandi has been indirect and creeping, an incremental systemic assault for the past 10 years. The Modi government has consistently sought to erase the distinction between the party and the state by undermining and capturing all the mechanisms that seek executive accountability. It is killing our constitution by a thousand cuts. I'm going to point out a few of the particularly bloody cuts. In the first test, democracies seek electoral accountability from the political executive. Measures such as electoral manipulation, voter disenfranchisement, biased campaign finance over time give the ruling party an unfair advantage. Voter disenfranchisement has reached epic proportions in India. In the past general elections, as well as in the recent bipolls in many BJP-ruled states, there were widespread, documented, caught on television cameras, caught on mobile phones, instances of voter suppression, from names missing to electoral rolls, by police used to threaten, beat and intimidate voters. We saw it in Rampur, we saw it in Sambal. Entire localities were being forced to stay home. Another aspect is the largely targeted exclusion of a hated minority by a prejudiced majoritarian state, creating a whole section of second-class citizens whose rights are less equal than others. This government brought in a discriminatory Citizenship Amendment Act that is openly violative of the fundamental right to equality before law. All the BJP state governments are competing with each other in bulldozer justice, demolishing homes, usually of minorities, without due process of law. I had to go to the Supreme Court to get a stay on the unconditional and on the unconstitutional order of the UP government, demanding that minorities, that Muslims, put identifying markers on their eateries in shops during the Kavad Yatra. This is blatantly a violative of Article 15. Let us move on to campaign finance now. In 2014, both the BJP and the Congress were held liable for illegally accepting foreign contributions. In response, this government retrospectively amended the Foreign Contribution Regulatory Act, FCRA 2010, to narrow the definition of a foreign company and thereby remove the illegality with retrospective effect. This was done surreptitiously. The Act of 2010 was not amended by a separate bill. It was done via clauses slipped into the Finance Act 2016 and the Finance Act 2018. The amendments not only legalized foreign funding of political parties, they also created a new funding vehicle called electoral bonds. In 2017-18, the BJP got 97.7% of funds that were legalized by surreptitious changes to the campaign finance laws. When the electoral bond numbers came out earlier this year, we saw that the BJP had between 54% and 57% of the total amount raised in the past 6 years. This kind of unfair advantage for the BJP in campaign finance has created a very skewed playing field for the opposition in recent years. There's no denying this. The use of the government funds to promote BJP and to promote Modi ji's political branding in the run-up to the elections, Modi ji ki guarantee, Modi ji ka parivar, creates a media blitzkrieg that few smaller parties can match. For a free and fair electoral process, a neutral referee is necessary. So in addition to electoral accountability, our constitution lays down a second check of institutional accountability, where the government is scrutinized by the judiciary and by various fourth branch institutions, such as the Election Commission, the Vigilance Commission, a human rights watchdog, an anti-corruption body. The appointment mechanism of these fourth branch institution, along with their functional autonomy, is what keeps them independent. What has this government done? This government willfully defied the spirit of the Supreme Court ruling on the Election Commission's independence by replacing the Chief Justice of India on the selection committee with a government-appointed minister. So you have a 2-to-1 majority. Prior to Modi ji becoming Prime Minister, how often did we hear of an election commissioner not filling their full term? Ever since this government has come in, two election commissioners have inexplicably quit before their terms have ended. The 2024 elections saw egregious violations of the model code of conduct by the BJP, and specifically by the Prime Minister, which an eager and compliant commission blatantly ignored. But even the smallest violation by an opposition party saw the ECI taking prompt, stringent action. For free and fair elections, just like justice, must not only be done, but must also be seen to be done. So public trust in democracy has to be restored by this election commission. We've jokingly started calling it the Modi ji code of conduct. Other institutional bodies have been similarly compromised. Appointments to the National Human Rights Commission have been widely criticized, especially of Justice Arun Mishra and others close to the establishment. This is a judge who, while in office, heaped praise on Modi ji, calling him an international visionary who thought globally and acted locally. And lest the Treasury benches claim this assessment is a biased one, please remember, it is precisely this kind of appointments that have undermined the independence of the NHRC, so much so that the NHRC has lost its UN accreditation. The NHRC can no longer represent India or vote at the UN Council of Human Rights. Allow me to turn to a simple instance of what human rights under the rule of law means: the right to bail. The erstwhile outgoing Chief Justice of India waxed eloquent recently about how the right to bail has been granted during his tenure for all. A range of under trials, from A to Arnab to Z for Zubair. His alphabet unfortunately seems abbreviated because it did not include G for Gulfisha Fatima, didn't include H for Hani Babu, didn't include K for Khalid Safi, didn't include S for Sharjul Imam, and U for Omar Khalid, and countless others. The former Chief Justice made it a point to say that the Supreme Court is not meant to act like the political opposition. We in the political opposition don't need the Supreme Court to do our job. We are not asking it to. But what troubles us is that some members of the higher judiciary appear to be doing their best to compromise the independence and integrity of our constitutional courts. I do not think that the framers of our constitution ever imagined a scenario where judges would rely on private conversations with God to write judgments rather than on objective logic, on reasoning, and on the law and the constitution. The Honourable Defence Minister in a speech this morning mentioned the courage of the late Justice H.R. Khanna to dissent in 1976. May I remind everyone that Justice Khanna lived for 32 years after 1976 under a largely Congress regime, long enough to write his autobiography, which the Minister quoted from. Unlike poor Justice Lohia, who's resting in peace long before his time. Delays in filling vacancies in the Central Information Commission is denying citizens their right to information. Currently, the CIC has only 3 commissioners, including the chief, instead of the mandated 10, and has 22,000 pending appeals filed by people against the denial of information by this government. The third dimension of executive accountability is discursive accountability. Citizens in a democracy expect their government to be able to justify their actions by way of public discourse with civil society. This government on a daily basis is pursuing unconstitutional methods of restricting freedom of the press and freedom of speech. Its ill-conceived amendments to the IT rules to create fact-checking units was recently struck down by the Bombay High Court as being violative of Articles 14 and 19 of the Constitution. The latest UP police cases against fact-checker Mohammad Zubair, when the UP police is invoking de facto sedition against a fact-checker who is documenting hate speech. This is preposterous. I am one of the petitioners challenging the constitutionality of the sedition law, and the Supreme Court has very clearly stated that no coercive action will be taken on alleged sedition cases till the matter is decided. Yet the government doesn't stop. The Bharatiya Nyay Samhita, which the ruling party brought in last year when most of the parliamentarians were suspended, they said we are dropping sedition, but you also replaced it with a far more draconian Section 152. There's also something else which we all need to think about. The BNS for the first time adds terrorism as a punishable offence and defines it as an act that intends to threaten the unity, integrity and security. So the crime of terrorism is no longer anchored in an actual act. It's anchored in an intent or a thought. This means that from now onwards, the parents of disappearing Kashmiris or disappearing Manipuris who are protesting peacefully in a park can be accused of being terrorists. What they do or do not do in that park while they assemble is besides the point. As long as a police officer is convinced that they have the intent to do something, they can be terrorists. Yeah. This makes terrorism a thought crime. Madam Chairperson, this is closer to the letter and spirit of the dystopian reality in George Orwell's 1984 than it is to the Constitution of India. Let me turn to how the policy of 1,000 cuts has damaged our institutions. Institutions like the Enforcement Directorate and the CBI have turned into extortionist departments for the government. 14 political parties approached the Supreme Court against the coercive criminal actions of these two agencies. 95% of cases by these two agencies are against opposition politicians. Since 2014, 25 opposition leaders facing corruption have crossed over to the BJP. 23 of them have got reprieves. 3 cases are closed. 20 cases are stalled. For years, the CBI was used to put pressure on NDTV and its promoters via a bogus case. Now that the channel's been captured, it's been sanitized, CBI says that there was never any case to start with. Airports and large infrastructure have been captured by crony capitalists by similar misuse of the ED and the CBI. In a cooked-up case against me, the CBI is wasting precious time and resources looking for a scarf and lipstick that a friend gifted me. These actions have cost India the first ever human rights violation by the Interparliamentary Union in Geneva, the global body governing all national legislatures. After the abrogation of Article 370, there has been a flagrant crackdown of the constitutional rights of the people of Kashmir. Free speech and movement have been hampered. Passports cancelled without any pending cases. Never heard of it. Manipur, an integral part of the Union of India, seems to have a complete breakdown of constitutional machinery. The failure of governance is stark. The Union government under Article 355 of the Constitution is obligated to assist states in the maintenance of law and order. In May 2024, in the Supreme Court, Solicitor General stood up and said the violence is subsiding. Yet, horrifying incidents are happening every day. I petitioned the Supreme Court in the Manipur violence case. Senior Advocate Indira Jaisingh appeared for me. An expert committee was set up. But then after 27 or more hearings, there is no relief, there is no justice yet. Time constraints don't allow a more in-depth analysis, but it is crystal clear that this political executive for the past 10 years has systematically eroded democracy. It failed spectacularly on all three tests of constitutional accountability laid out by Professor Khaitan. Our constitution is bleeding from a thousand cuts. Samvidhan khatre mein zarur hai. The need of this hour is to ensure that the idea of India survives in its purest form. This burden is heavier on some of us than on others. The judiciary and the media have a far greater responsibility in protecting our constitution than to normal citizens. History will not be kind to you, your lords and ladyships, if you falter. To every Chief Justice of India, past and present, I say this. Yours is not to worry about your personal legacy. Yours is not to take directions from God. Yours is not to have a private family function turned into a televised circus for the political executive. The Constitution is your only God. The Constitution should be the only Atithi who should be in your home as your Deva. Attention-seeking divas do not leave legacies. Upholders and protectors of our basic sovereign rights will only be remembered. To the media, I say, you play a huge role in guaranteeing our democracy's survival. Live up to it. To taking a few liberties with Faiz Ahmed Faiz's immortal words, let me tell you. Sab taaj uchhale jayenge, sab takht giraye jayenge. Bas naam rahega samvidhan ka. In conclusion, I pay homage to the 17 women of India's Constituent Assembly who laid the path for all of us like me to stand here today. And I would like to remind us of Vijayalakshmi Pandit's words. Freedom is not for the timid. Protecting our constitution in these harrowing times requires courage. Let us rise to it. We will succeed. Jai Hind.